February is Black History Month, and so I wanted to begin today not only with the music of jazz virtuoso Miles Davis, but just as importantly, I wanted to share some words from him. While instructing a young pianist who was trying to learn how to accompany the extemporaneous impromptu genius of Davis's playing, something that would be intimidating for anyone, never mind a young musician, Davis, not known for his patience with anyone, never mind musicians, who couldn't keep up with his musical prowess, says to the new keyboarder, "Don't lean into what you know. Lean into what you don't know." Last week, I referenced in my weekly e-blast to you as a congregation about the Celtic festival known as Imbolg, an oldest time marking of the anticipation of spring. And beside this being a annual celebration at the beginning of each February within the Celtic culture, my deeper point in acknowledging it was how its observance is one that takes place while still in the throes of a bleak midwinter, the season of deep unknowns. The timing of this observance is no accident to my mind. It is more than just about stirring false optimism in the wintertime, anticipating spring, or keeping up morale during dark times. It is saying there is no spring without winter. And while winter is no state to permanently wish upon anyone, winter amplifies a human condition we need as much as anything else, and that we are the better for when we name it and embrace it, when we lean into the unknowns. Catherine May is the author of a book entitled Wintering, The Power of Rest and Retreat in Difficult Times. She writes, "Wintering is a time of withdrawing from the world, maximizing scant resources, carrying out acts of brutal efficiency, and vanishing from sight. That's where the transformation occurs." She reminds us that plants and animals don't fight or deny the winter. They adapt. And the evidence of their adaptation, their transformation, is evolution. How are human beings any different? May's appeal is for us to become wintering warriors. The numbers revealing the crisis of mental health trauma is real these days, isn't it? And surreal. 1 in 6 of us who never engaged in any form of emotional, psychological, or spiritual care before COVID-19 are doing so now. And this in addition to the already over 30% of North Americans who are already doing so before 2020. I suggest to you that these numbers are not because of COVID-19 directly, or winter directly, or both. I suggest to you that it is because of how poorly prepared we are in responding to COVID-19, to winter, or both. This winter of our discontent is not curtailed by wishful thinking. As social activist Deirdre Pike wrote in an op-ed last weekend in the Hamilton Spectator, "This winter," she writes, "I've been trying to listen more deeply, remember more fully, and seek more sincerely." Pike is consciously seeking not to do what many try and do when they, and she cites this, pretend that it's summer all year round. When learning that Jesus had healed Simon's mother-in-law, the entire city of Capernaum in first century Palestine shows up outside the door where Jesus was, waiting to be healed of any number of illnesses, given this rumor that had come their way about this one who can heal. They wait in line for their vaccine. After pulling off another night shift of healing, Jesus is exhausted. And the text in Mark says the following: in the morning, while it was still very dark, Jesus got up and went out to a deserted place and prayed. Jesus didn't run away. He didn't repress. He sought reprieve and retreat. Let's put this in the vernacular of what I've been trying to suggest to this point, at least. Jesus wintered. In the words of Catherine May, or borrowing from the words of Catherine May, Jesus withdrew from the world into the dark unknown. He maximized his scant resources, carried out acts of brutal efficiency, and vanished from sight, at least for a while. The story tells us that it was early in the morning when Jesus got up, and so there must have been a crisp anticipation of hope in the air to the start of the day, in his lungs, in his heart, in his mind, his spirit. But it was still dark. Matter of fact, the text says very dark, and therefore was without the clarity that daybreak affords. And yet it is in this darkness that we can best pray. Darkness may be the only condition in which we can ultimately know the whole truth of what we don't know or can't control. Because prayer itself, like learning how to play jazz piano with Miles Davis, is a leaning into the unknown. Think of the gesture we instinctively perform when we enter intentionally into prayer, publicly or privately. We do what? Close our eyes. We withdraw to the darkness, to the unknown. Surely this image and practice has much to teach us and how to respond to our circumstances in everyday life when our eyes are open. I was reminded this past week by a colleague of someone who knew all too well the unknowns of darkness. And yet it was in darkness where she forever demonstrated her zeal for life. Although the world is full of suffering, wrote Helen Keller, it is also full of the overcoming of it. Helen Keller was a wintering warrior. This pandemic has provided an opportunity for us to winter in ways we have never had to do before, to foster a relationship with the unknown that invites us into a new way of being, allowing us to become who we really are and only attend to those things which can make us whole and, frankly, are the only things which really matter. So let us, as it says in Proverbs, lean not on our own understanding, because, frankly, our toolkit is inadequate for these times that we are presented with. Instead, let us lean into the unknown, not because we can't trust God, but because, as Augustine observed, if we understand it, then it is not God. Let us not permit this winter to be defined by our discontent. Rather, let us allow the level of our discontent to be defined by our wintering. Amen. Thank you.